This is me talking to you from my office in Pune, and very good morning, Madam Shalini Singh. This is Kamath here.
Good morning, Mr. Kamath. I joined in, but unfortunately, I could hear you. You couldn't hear me.
Yeah. We could see your video on, and Mr. Rahul, can we also see you?
I can see you, Professor, but I have a problem with my camera, so my video won't be get enabled.
Okay, no problem. I think this is the new normal.
Thank you so much for giving time for this discussion.
Our pleasure, sir. Thank you so much. Our pleasure.
From ASAP side, I would like to let you know that two top officials will be joining. One is our community skill partner, Vinod TV, and another one is our curriculum division head, Dr. J. Kiran sir.
Okay.
Right now they are attending a meeting, but they will be joining in another 5-10 minutes.
Okay. Super. So we start sharp at 10 o'clock, right?
Yes.
Super. So we keep our video and audio off till they join.
Yes. And Nirbhay sir, I have given the presenter privilege. You can now share your screen from your laptop.
Okay. My colleague Shashi Anand will do that. Shashi, can you please share your screen?
No. First presentation is by Capital Goods. So yes. The presentation will be uploaded from Nirbhay sir's laptop.
Okay, super.
So first I have given the presenter privilege to Nirbhay sir.
Absolutely, no problem.
After that, I will shift to Shashi Anand sir.
Yes, perfect. Okay, thank you. See you in a little while. See you, madam, in a little while.
See you.
സാറിനെ വിളിച്ചിട്ട് എടുക്കുന്നില്ല ആണോ സാറോ സാറിനെ ഒന്ന് കണക്ട് ചെയ്തത് കേട്ടോ എന്നിട്ട് Kamath sir and Shantanath, our Vinod sir has joined for the session. Shalini ma'am.
Good morning, this is Kamath here from Fronius India.
Yeah, Mr. Kamath, good morning. Everybody else are also there, right? Ms. Shalini, Mr. Partha Saradi,
yes.
Dinesh and Ashish are there, right?
Yes, absolutely. All of us are there.
Yeah. So we are at 10 now. The scheduled time is also 10.
Yes.
I think, Rahul, are you there also?
Yes, I am here, sir.
So you have the documentation team and everybody else, sir?
Everybody online, sir. Everybody online.
So shall we start now or what should I do?
We can start now, sir. It's already 10.
Yeah. Okay. Mr. Kamath, excuse me, I would like to explain the context of this webinar session to the people, and I will have to select my native language for that.
Perfect.
Yeah. Yes. You know, in the during the initial stage, I will be giving you to also make you acquainted with the situation and to have a perfect link. I will initially talk with in English, and then we'll be switching over to my native language to help the people to give a context detail.
Perfect.
As you might have heard from my colleague, Mr. Rahul, you know, ASAP is doing a lot of things to make use of the opportunity that is in fact a blessing in disguise, I must say. And the every world is suffering from the hardships of due to the impact of the pandemic. We have been trying to find solution one of the most alarming problems in Kerala, that is the underemployment. In a sense, I must say that the Keralites are having the biggest community who have access to higher education, all kinds of higher education, and we are in fact fascinated by the opportunities, and everybody thinks that acquiring the maximum possible education is the best way to get their progressive career opportunity. It is a discussion point that if we have to have educated youngsters or skilled youngsters. So that is let the community and the people concerned discuss about that. However, to contain the underemployment rather than the unemployment, we really have to help our educated job aspirants bridging their skill gap by acquiring additional skills that will enable them to become industry relevant and get their best career opportunities. We have my colleague, Mr. Jayakiran, also joined the session. He is heading the curriculum development division of ASAP, and he is there for almost 70 years. In fact, a veteran in ASAP, I must say, who knows all the loops and the development, who have been taking the initiative and the development stage itself. So
good now, morning.
Good morning.
Making use of the opportunity, we have been trying to seek the support of experts and eminent knowledgeable personalities like you, so that we will be creating an awareness of the education for getting themselves. Or I think we have almost a year, because the recruitment around the globe will be on hold for at least a year. And by this time, if the educated youngsters are getting enough skills in the related field, they could definitely get onto their dream jobs once the recruitment starts off. And for those who are, you know, already joined in the session, either Capital Goods Sector Skill Council, Pradhana Petta Bharavakyalum, ee sectoriles, valare adhigam kaalathe anubhavajnanavum, vyavasayika parijnanavum okke ulla, pinne valare eminent aayittulla moonnalu panelistukalaanu namukku kittittullathu. ഈ ഡിസ്കഷൻ ലീഡ് ചെയ്യുന്നത് മിസ്റ്റർ വി വി കാമത്ത്. ഹി ഈസ് ദി മാനേജിംഗ് ഡയറക്ടർ ഓഫ് ഫ്രോണ്ടിയേഴ്സ് ഇന്ത്യ പ്രൈവറ്റ് ലിമിറ്റഡ്. നമ്മോടൊപ്പം മിസ് ശാലിനി സിക്യൂട്ടർ, ഷി ഈസ് ദി ചീഫ് ഓപ്പറേറ്റിംഗ് ഓഫീസർ സി ജി ക്യാപിറ്റൽ ഗുഡ്സ് സെക്ടർ സ്കിൽ കൗൺസിൽ. അതോടൊപ്പം തന്നെ മിസ്റ്റർ പാർത്ഥസാരഥി ശശിയാനന്ദ്, സെഗ്മെന്റ് മാനേജർ അറ്റ് ഫ്രോണിയേഴ്സ്. നമുക്ക് ജിനേഷ് കെ പി എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ സിസ്റ്റം ടീം ഉണ്ട് ഫ്രം ഫ്രോണിയേഴ്സ് ഇറ്റ്സെൽഫ്. Ashish Apte, it's a good team, and they are Ray Srivastava from Capital Goods Sector Skill Council. Capital Goods Sector Skill Council nu parayumbo pradhanamayi oru pakshe ivide ee session le login cheyidavarku endana capital goods ennu ariyan padillathavar undengil avarku vendi parayam. നമ്മള് ഈ പിന്നെ ഇൻഡസ്ട്രിയലൈസേഷൻ, വ്യാവസായിക വിപ്ലവം, മൂന്നാം വ്യാവസായിക വിപ്ലവത്തിന്റെ ഭാഗമായിട്ടാണ് കൂടുതൽ ടെക്നോളജി ഡ്രിവൺ എക്യുപ്മെന്റ്സ്, ക്യാപിറ്റൽ എക്യുപ്മെന്റ്സ് നമ്മളുടെ ഇവിടെ ഇൻഡസ്ട്രിയൽ സെക്ടറുകളിലും കാർഷിക മേഖലകളിലും ഒക്കെ ഉപയോഗിച്ചിട്ടുള്ളത്. പിന്നെ നമ്മുടെ സ്പേസ് സയൻസ് ഉൾപ്പെടെയുള്ള മേഖലകളിലൊക്കെ നമുക്ക് ക്യാപിറ്റൽ ഗുഡ്സ് കൊണ്ടുവരികയാണ്. അപ്പം ക്യാപിറ്റൽ ഗുഡ്സ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ പ്രധാനമായും യന്ത്ര സഹായത്തോടെ പ്രവർത്തിക്കുന്ന മാനുഫാക്ചറിങ് ഫെസിലിറ്റികളോ ഒക്കെയാണ് ഇത് പറയുക. നമ്മള് മിക്കവാറും മാനുഫാക്ചറിങ് ഇൻഡസ്ട്രിക്കൊക്കെ തന്നെ ഇതേപോലെയുള്ള വിവിധ യന്ത്ര ഭാഗങ്ങളും പൂർണ്ണമായോ ഭാഗികമായോ മറ്റ് രാജ്യങ്ങളിൽ നിന്ന് ഇമ്പോർട്ട് ചെയ്ത് കൊണ്ടുവന്നിട്ട് കുറെയൊക്കെ ഇവിടെ തന്നെ നമ്മൾ ഉത്പാദനം, പിന്നീട് മേക്ക് ഇൻ ഇന്ത്യ മറ്റ് നടപടികൾ മൂലം മറ്റ് ഇനിഷ്യേറ്റീവ്സ് മൂലം നമ്മൾ ക്യാപിറ്റൽ ഗുഡ്സിൽ ഉൾപ്പെടെയുള്ള പല യന്ത്ര ഭാഗങ്ങളും ഇവിടെ തന്നെ ഉത്പാദിപ്പിക്കുന്നുണ്ട്. മുൻകാലങ്ങളിൽ നമ്മൾ ഇതിനെ കൂടുതലും ക്യാപിറ്റൽ ഗുഡ്സ് ഇമ്പോർട്ട് ചെയ്യുകയാണ് ചെയ്തിരുന്നത് മറ്റ് ഇൻഡസ്ട്രിയലൈസ്ഡ് കൺട്രികളിൽ നിന്ന്. അപ്പോ ഈ ക്യാപിറ്റൽ ഗുഡ്സ് ഇതിന്റെ ഉപയോഗം ഈ വ്യാവസായിക ഉൽപാദന മേഖലകളിൽ വലിയ സ്കെയിലിലേക്ക് ആകുമ്പോൾ അതിന്റെ മെയിൻ്റനൻസ്, അതിന്റെ ഡിസൈനിങ്, അതിന്റെ മാനുഫാക്ചറിങ്, അതിന്റെ ടെക്നോളജി, ഈ മേഖലകളിലൊക്കെ വലിയ തൊഴിൽ സാധ്യതകളുണ്ട്. അത്തരത്തിലുള്ള തൊഴിൽ സാധ്യതകളിലേക്ക് നമുക്ക് വിരൽ ചൂണ്ടാനും അതിലേക്കുള്ള ഇൻഫർമേഷൻ നമുക്ക് തരുന്നതിനും ജോബ് റോൾസ്, അതിനകത്ത് വേണ്ട സ്കിൽസ് ഒക്കെ സംബന്ധിച്ച് വിശദമായി നമ്മളോട് സംവദിക്കുന്നതിനാണ് ബഹുമാന്യരായ പാനലിസ്റ്റുകൾ ഇന്ന് നമ്മളോടൊപ്പം ഉള്ളത്. Let us hear them, from them, what are the opportunities in the capital goods sector, the job roles which will be emerging post COVID, because as in every sector, the manufacturing sector will also be undergoing tremendous changes. Bells are ringing and we have started hearing smart manufacturing terminologies like smart manufacturing. So we will have to know more details about how the manufacturing sector, especially with the largest component of capital goods, will be emerging, and what are the job roles, skills, etc., which would be required in the post-COVID scenario. Mr. Kamath and his team will be having a detailed discussion on all these aspects and will tell us. Over to you, Mr.
So let me add a few points before we start with the other side.
Please, sir.
First of all, I'm so happy to see top leaders from Fronius and the Capital Goods Sector Skill Council. This morning, I just Googled to find out what Fronius is. And I was so happy to see that this company started immediately after the World War II, started with car battery charging. Now it's a world leader in almost all areas of technology. So we are very happy to have with us the managing director of such a firm having a global footprint. Also, Capital Goods Sector Skill Council, I have seen some of the functionaries during our NSQC meetings. So I'm so happy to see Mrs. Shalini Singh ma'am, who is the Chief Operating Officer. And we understand that it's a pioneer as far as the skill development in the capital goods sector is concerned. I just want to add one point as far as the state is concerned, because you might know that already there is a great wave of return migration from, especially from Gulf region. According to the estimates of the non-resident Kerala Association Department, during the last 3 years, we have some 39 lakh people who are already here in the state. And this is going to increase over the next few years. So we are having, we are going to deal with a huge problem here. So many of these people are skilled, semi-skilled and professionals. There is every chance that a chunk of this population is having a already working experience in this capital goods machinery area. So this is where the role of Fronius and the Capital Goods Sector Skill Council, which is involved in skill development for the whole country, is concerned. So we have a huge manpower here, which can be trained properly, upskilled, given short upskill training programs, and this can be used by the whole country, and we can even channelize this for the other migration corridors in the future. So I would request Fronius and Capital Goods Sector Council to keep this point in your mind when you discuss possibilities as far as engaging with the community skill parks are concerned. Thank you so much, and over to you, Kamath sir.
Thank you. Very good morning to all the participants from the God's own country, Kerala, and also from the people across the country. So what a day today. I'm sitting in Pune office and listening to you. You are at Kerala. Ms. Shalini Singh and Mr. Srivastava and my colleague Ashish Shapte are based out of Delhi. And my one colleague Shashi, who is going to talk to you, is from Chennai. And Mr. Jinesh, the son of the soil from Kerala, will be talking from his home. And technology made it very possible. I would say that I think we must thank COVID-19 for this. Mr. Vinod, thank you very much for your inaugural address. Dr. Jai Kiran, thank you so much for introducing Fronius so beautifully. And Ms. Shalini Singh and Mr. Nirbhay Srivastava, thank you very much for giving us this opportunity to talk to the most educated state of India. Even though the state is very small in terms of the area, but it contributes to 4% of the GDP of our country, and a very big foreign remittance comes from the Keralites. As Mr. Vinod and Mr. Jai Kiran said, you can find Keralites or Malayalis everywhere in every part of the world. I'm just about Kerala. I'm from Mangalore, so I know the people are quite enterprising, would like to acquire skill. Mr. Vinod said, the time has come to realize whether the educational qualification, the degrees are important or the skills are important. I think every adversity brings an opportunity, and this is a time that last 9 weeks has made us introspect a lot. And I think this is a very powerful statement Mr. Vinod made, that whether the educational qualifications are important or skills are important. I think the survey says, from KPMG and also from the various other surveying agencies, talks about only 4% of the engineering graduates are employable, and their salary is less than 15,000-20,000 rupees per month. But a person who has an additional skill, who can earn maybe 50,000-70,000 rupees per month. So that's the earning potential which is there if you are additionally skilled. And ASAP, the Additional Skill Acquisition Program, I think it's one of the unique program, and what a state to start. Kerala is the perfect state. And like Dr. Jai Kiran talked about, people coming back from the other parts of the world back, and they have been skilled with certain skills, but now the time is to upgrade it. You put it, Fronius, yes, we started in 1945, and 2020 is exactly the 75th year for Fronius. And we are already into the third generation. The granddaughter of Mr. Fronius is our present CEO. Her name is Mrs. Elizabeth Strauss. So my company is led by a woman. And in 1945, we started with the battery charging during the World War for Austrian Army. And in 1950, we started the welding. And in 1992, we started the solar energy business. I'm very happy to say that in Kerala, we hold more than 40% market share on the residential rooftop. People who have a residential rooftop, the solarized, you can see a Fronius inverter there. We have been empaneled with Kerala government because of our quality, and we hold, I think it's the highest market share ever we hold in India, that's in Kerala, that's more than 40%. When it comes to welding, we did little bit of initiatives with some of the private institutes in Kerala. We started a center of excellence with Little Flower Engineering Institute in Cochin a year back, thanks to Father Joby, who took this initiative. And we have a robotic welding lab and also a virtual welding setup in Cochin. And we have been training there people who want to become a robotic operator, which is going to be the future. We also joined hands with Skillsonics of, it's a Switzerland based company. And we put up a small center of excellence in welding at the TSS Trivandrum. So in a small way we started, and also I take pride in being a welding partner to Cochin Shipyard. We have played a important role in the aircraft carrier, integrated aircraft carrier was welded using using Fronius technology. When coming to the topic of today, that how do we upskill the people? People are skilled in Kerala. How do we upskill them and offer an employment opportunity post-COVID? I must tell you that India has moved three places up in robotic consumption in 2019. We already crossed 5,000 robotic consumption per year, and it's expected to grow at a CAGR of at least 17 to 25% for next 5 years. But if you look at our robotic consumption is 99 robots per 10,000 people. That is just 1%. Look at country like Indonesia, the smallest country, they are 454 robots per 10,000 people. And if you look at China, it is 750. And the market leader in Asia or to the world is South Korea, which is 2,600 robots. That is 26% for 10,000 workmen. So we have an umpteen opportunity for the people to upgrade their skill from a welder to a robotic operator, because you cannot just operate a robotic welding just because you're an operator. You have to have an knowledge of the welding. Also the semi-automation systems to operate the cross-country pipeline. Also the investment from the government in the infrastructure segment will also call for, I'm sure, my friends from Capital Goods will agree, there would be a lot of investment in the infrastructure which will lead to a yellow goods demand. And one yellow goods, for example, what we generally call it as JCB, what we saw on the roadside, to manufacture one JCB, you require 1 ton of welding electrodes. So to consume so many welders are also required. So I'm very optimistic post-COVID. The capital goods will have a very good scope. Just to give a last shot for my this address, gentlemen, we all talk about China and India rival. I must tell you, bring in certain points. China contributes 28% of global production, 28%, vis-a-vis India contributes only 3% of global production. With 3%, if your economy is doing so far so good, just imagine even at 2% of global production shift to India, you can imagine the potential available. 3 to 5% itself is in a big jump. And I think thanks to this lockdown, and thanks that we are all connected now, let's get upskilled ourselves. Let's see the ways to move forward. And Fronius India is quite open in association with the various government agencies and Capital Goods Council, that we are quite happy to upskill our countrymen with the best of the technology from Austria, so that we can be the world a leader in, or the global production hub for the entire world. So that's all from my side. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, And over to you, Dr. Jaikiran sir. Thank you very much.
No, thank you. Thank you, sir, for that very brief yet comprehensive presentation on the capital goods scene as far as Fronius is concerned. And I didn't know that Fronius is having such huge footprints in Kerala state, even in Trivandrum. So that makes our job easier to get connected. And with the Capital Goods Sectoral Council also with us, because additional skill acquisition program has been working with Capital Goods Sectoral Council right from the year 2013 or 14. So we have very strong connections as far as skill development is concerned. So this is, we can leverage the strength of Fronius and CPSC as far as skill development is concerned. And as Kamatsar rightly pointed out, there is huge opportunity as far as robotics and other areas are concerned. And given the trends shifting from shifting of production from China to India, even if there is a 1% change, there is going to be huge demand for skilled manpower. So let's keep those projections in mind and go ahead with as to what we can do. Now, I would request Shalini Singh ma'am to tell us as to what all major programs are Capital Goods Sectoral Council is doing and how additional skill acquisition program can benefit from any of them and how we can bring in the expertise of Fronius for skill development in the community skill parks of Kerala. Ma'am, please.
First of all, good morning to all of you. And thank you, Dr. Jaikiran. And thank you, Dr. Jaikiran and Vinod TV and entire ASAP Kerala team to invite me and my colleague Nirbhay on this platform, which is arranged primarily for young youth of Kerala. So we would also like to take this opportunity on behalf of CGSC. We will talk about overview of the capital goods sector industry. We'll talk about the demand and supply. We'll talk about various industrial weighted job roles available, including emerging job roles, which are there. I would also like to thank Mr. Kamath. I think he has fully explained the role of capital goods and the emerging job roles. So perhaps I would skip to the basic overview of the Capital Goods Sector Skill Council and so on and so forth. Now, next, we would also like to share some government initiatives along with role of Sector Skill Council in entire skill ecosystem. So when I talk about entire skill ecosystem, I'm talking about the stakeholders in the skill ecosystem. So there are four major stakeholders in the system. One is the individuals who invest in skills. They are primarily students and, you know, employees who are already working in this organization, various organization. There are education and training system, which delivers training through training partners, to government institutes, to ITIs, to higher education department. And then we have the industry who leverage this skilled manpower for their business outcomes. The fourth comes the policy makers who leverage, who delivers the strategy to develop skill development. So this includes all the state skill missions, ASAP, Kerala government, sector skill council, who work very closely with industries and deliver these programs. I'll just run through a small PPT, which will give a brief overview on the capital goods sector and role of Capital Goods Skill Council, which is part of the government initiative. Nirbhay, can you just start the PPT? I can see that. Hello? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I have shared it.
Okay. Because I can't see that PPT. Anyways, talking about briefly about the definition of, since the students are over here and I'm sure they know a lot about capital goods sector, but just to give you a, you know, basic information, capital goods refers to machinery and equipment required for the production of other products, and they're not for direct consumption. Now, this would include machine tools, industrial machinery, process plant equipment, construction, mining equipment, electrical equipment, machinery, printing, packaging, machinery, and so on and so forth. Now, the capital goods, just to give you an idea, this 12% of the manufacturing sector, which translates to 2% of the GDP of the entire ecosystem. As far as the employment is concerned, the it employs directly 1.4 million people and about another 7 million individual indirectly. Next. Anyway, next. I will talk about the major subsectors in capital goods sector. Machine tool, there are around 10 subsectors which are of prime importance to capital goods sector. Machine tools being one of them. This is the largest, I would say, the contributor as far as the market size is concerned. Power and electrical equipment. Now, power and electrical equipment constitutes machines related to power generation, transmission, and distribution. Process plant machinery constitutes machines such as pressure vessels, evaporators, stirrers, heat exchangers, etc. Textile machinery is another one which constitutes machines used in various steps of textile fabrication. Plastic and paper rubber machinery, which constitutes machinery used in various fabrication steps of paper, plastic, and rubber manufacturing. Then we have light engineering goods, which again includes machines related to roller bearing, process control instruments, casting, steel forging, and pipes, etc., used in oil and gas, power and automotive sector. Earth moving construction, mining equipment is another one. Material handling and lifting equipment, which includes forklifts, cranes used in various infrastructure, this thing. Then agriculture machinery, and then come the industrial automation. Nirbhay, can you just run this slide, because I can see this slide properly. Now, in the subsectors, I would say the highest market share, which is there, is primarily by the power and electric sectors and machine and tools subsector. Machine tool is, I would say, is the key sector for development of manufacturing sector. It's a major contributes in defense, railways, engineering, infrastructure, etc., and also for the SME growth. Next. I will touch upon basically the National Capital Goods Skill Policy. Now, Union Government in 2016 unveiled this National Good Policy under Skill India Mission. And the idea why this was in view of various challenges. Now, one was the growth rate at that point of time, I'm talking about 2016 and 13, the growth was very slow. It was as less as 1.1%. Global exports share was only 0.8%, and there was a very low level of skill development in the sector. To address these challenges and various other challenges, National Capital Goods Policy was launched in 2016. The prime motive was to increase exports from 27% of the production to 40%, push for domestic production. Second, improvement in technology. Now, this policy aims to increase the skill availability, improve technology, promote growth and capacity building of micro, small and medium enterprises. Technology Development Fund, it was the Technology Development Fund will be started under the PPP mode after the transfer of technology and commercialized capital goods technology. The other objective was to integrate subsectors, the policy, all the subsectors which I've just mentioned, and also introduce mandatory standards and reduce substandard machinery. Startup center, the policy also plans to have a startup center to aid startups in the manufacturing sector. Now, this will offer business support to the startups. Standardization was another objective which aims to mandatory standardization, which includes defining minimum standards and also the adoption of international standards for the machinery that is being used in capital goods. The skill development. This was primarily to address the challenge of low level of skill development in the sector through training and development. Now, the skill development is where we come in as a sector skill council. Next. This is a key highlight which I've already discussed, where we talk about the objectives was to increase the production from 2,30,000 crores to 70,000, employment from 1.4 to this, domestic production, domestic capacity utilization, exports, and then Indian share of global exports from 0.8% to this percent. Anyway, can you just, because this PPT is not viewable, if you can just enlarge this. Anyway, can you just enlarge this? Okay. Now, since we
you can now, sorry, view to the full screen. View to the full screen, then it will come.
Okay, I'll
control L.
Now, coming to the focus subsectors and major clusters of capital goods, which we have already explained in the previous slide, machine tools, power and electric, textile machinery, process plant machinery, and plastic, paper, and rubber machineries are the five major subsectors which CGSE is focusing upon. If you look at the geographical presence, you would find that south, west, and north is a major clusters. And in that, the various locations where these capital goods industries are present, and there's a lot of employment opportunities available in these areas. Next, I'll just run through a little faster so that, you know, I think we have a little less time.
Background slide is there. Is it visible?
Can see that there's some issue. Anyways,
yeah, it's visible. Background slide.
Okay, now talking about the background, I mean, we'll talk about how the sector scale council came into the picture. There were 21 high growth sector which were identified by Planning Commission, which required focused intervention. This is, I'm talking about national capital goods policy. And hence, when the sector scale council was set up as an outcome of national scale policy, these SSCs were to be registered as either industry-led body or for profit society or a Section 8 companies. And as on date, we have 38 sector skill council, which has been set up. And capital goods sector skill council is one of them. So I'll just run through a little, you know, detailing about background of capital goods sector skill council. It was registered as a society on June 2013, and it's been operational from 2014. It's been almost 8 years of journey, promoted by FICCI, Department of Heavy Industries. It is anchored by capital goods industry with support from MSD and NSDC. Now, we are primarily representative of industry. We represent industry demand, bring the industry demand, and work closely with the government to come out with a various outcome-based job requirements, skill requirements, which is required in the industry to make the employment happening in across all states. Coming to the governing council, since CGSE represents a lot of industry, so these are the industries which are empaneled up with us. We work very closely with L&T, Thermex, Gainwell, BHEL, Star, and there are Festo, Bharat Forge, and then we have various associations. Now, when I say associations, means these associations are part of the subsectors like plastic machine manufacturing, process plant machinery, tool and gauge manufacturing associations. Now, under these associations, we have 200 to 500 smaller member companies who become a part of this association. So we work very closely with them in terms of industry knowledge, in terms of various qualifications that we want to develop for a cross-skilling ecosystem. The present chairman of CGSE is Mr. Sunil Chaturvedi, who is also the CMD of Gainwell Commosales, which is a ex-Caterpillar company. Next. Coming to how do we work, CGSE collaborate with various state skill missions, industries, and academia for assessment and certification. These are the few states which we have mentioned. And Kerala being one of them, we have been closely working with Kerala government also, ASAP also. There are various industry foundations where we work under their CSR divisions, under their training development, training department. and we work very closely with the skill requirement that they have and make the curriculum accordingly. Then we work with various skill university, which could be Chitkara University, Trident, BSDU, C.V. Raman College, NTTF, Don Bosco, and so on and so forth. I would also like to highlight over here is that since Dr. Vinod TV raised the point of the current situation of COVID-19 and how this is going to change. Now, this will, you know, in this entire ecosystem, we are very positive because every thing comes with a positive note also. Coming to the job requirements that I'm talking about, there is definitely going to be the 30% jobs will revamp and 30% jobs will come new in this current situation. Now, these jobs would be primarily, I would say, when it comes to the manufacturing sector, automation will definitely be required in manufacturing sector that is going to boost up. There would be machine learning part that is something which is going to come. There is going to be, like, for example, hospitals using robotics. That is the, you know, other area which we will be talking about. We are also working with Industry 4.0 job roles, which is emerging job roles, future job roles that's going to come in the future. And this is where we are talking about post-COVID. These are the job skills that would be required. They will also be, the nature of jobs will change. If I talk about Kerala, I mean, Ayurvedic is something which is very much there. Tourism is a sector which has got impacted. So this will remain for some time. But however, the other job roles, which is largely, if I talk about manufacturing sector, will arise. Robotics will arise. And there will be a lot of, I would say that more women workforce can join as work from home, where all it will happen on the activities. For example, if I talk about sales, there is going to be a contactless sales through automation skills, through IVR facility. These are the ways hospitals will be using robotics. So there is a lot of scope when it comes to the manufacturing industry and the future job roles that is going to come. There'll be a lot of opportunity in upskilling and reskilling on these. And there will be also a program of RPL, which is Recognition of Prior Learning, which is started by Government of India, which would be explained to you maybe in this during presentation. We will also talk about the National Occupancy Standards. We'll talk about the qualification packs, the job roles that is we have developed in consultation with various industry experts, and these are all validated by the industry. When I say validated by the industries, these are the job roles which is required by the industries. The curriculum and the qualification content is designed in consultation with various industries and is vetted by NSQF line course. I would request Nirbhay to take the rest of the presentation, which will talk about various job roles available with us in the EcoSkill ecosystem, where all the students can enroll themselves and understand what is the qualifications required, what is the minimum skill required for this, and how they can enroll in these courses. Nirbhay, to you, over to you.
Thank you, Shalini, and good morning, everyone. Now, what I'll take you towards is the National Occupational Standards that we have developed and the qualifications that we have developed in the, since 2013. So currently we have got about 55 qualifications pack which are ready. And Statistical Council is one of the council which is 100% manufacturing. We don't deal with sales and all those things. So we have the core manufacturing sectors. And all the qualifications that we have are NSQF aligned. There's a new qualification pack which has been recently developed and approved, which is called a stainless steel fabricator, which is again going to be in a high demand. So Capital Goods Skill Council, like all other skill councils, has been designated as an awarding body to certify the skills of individuals by government through a government gadget notification. And we also take a project with the states wherein we can deliver training and we do monitoring and project management also. So this is just a small snapshot of our occupational map. So while designing this occupational map, we have actually visited 270 companies and their shop floors. We have talked to people from the operator to the supervisor to the project engineer, and the HR to come out with these occupational map. So we have got, in total, we have got 369 job roles. The bifurcation of the same can be seen here. What I like to focus here upon is while we were drafting it, the industry felt that we should come out with special status to welding. So we have got 14 job roles that we have identified and which were related to welding. Robotics and other things are going to come up in a big way, and they are not included here, but we will be focusing on them in the within say year and a two. Now this is just a brief snapshot of the various job roles that Capital Goods Skill Council have. I have in this, what I have classified them is between occupations, what is the minimum education requirement, and what is the NSQF level of these job roles which are there. So we have got machining, cutting, welding, quality testing, fitting and assembly, designing, which includes 2D and 3D, coating and painting, machine installation, commissioning, quality testing and inspection, calibration and instrumentation, forging, maintenance, material preparation, and shop floor management. So there's a lot of scope which I see, which we see in Kerala, and that could be through a short-term training program, or could be a program wherein we embed these courses into engineering colleges, diploma colleges. You know, the difference between these job roles and the regular curriculum or the regular courses is, regular courses are developed by academicians and education institutes. However, this is something which we see as a demand. These all job roles that we make are industry demanded. So this is a demand side. The education has to support the supply, being a supply side has to support the demand side. This is just a detailed of the qualification pack which are readily available with us. So there is a lot of scope of reskilling and upskilling that we are in touch with different state governments. And these courses are not just for, say 5th class, 8th class, 10th class, but a lot of our courses are specifically meant for ITIs, diplomas, degree engineers. I'm just going through just a snapshot of all those that is available. And with workforce coming back from, say, different countries back to Kerala and India, there's a lot of scope that a change and shift that we are going to see in the employment which will be there. So we also did a small study of the industry, the MSMEs which are there in Kerala. So we just try to find out what are the job roles which may be of interest to these companies. So we have studied about 8 companies, different locations within Kerala. Then we found out, for example, Kathavali Electromechanical Industries is there. So these are the prime 3 job roles. Now within welding, there will be multiple kind of welding. We all think welding has to be a very the welding that is being done in and around our houses, but the welding, you know, is a very specialized technical course, and there are multiple types of welding that students and can pick up, and the pay range varies. It's not just the starting, but the pay range really varies in welding. So if you see here, we have done a study of 8 companies, their locations, their suggested job roles. Similarly, we just went through all the demand that we have for Kerala. So we got in touch with our placement partners. We got to find what is the number of welders that are required. And here is a snapshot. And you will see this is not less than 1,000 welders that are required in Kerala. So the jobs are there. You just have to prepare yourself and have to come up to that level, right? And next one is a CGST imperative for Industry 4.0. We all are talking about Industry 4.0. We are all listening about it. But the thing is, the government has started working towards it. Now, Industry 4.0 is not just a turnaround. There are multiple technologies that are required for it. So there are multiple options that has opened up for students at different level under Industry 4.0. Now, the adoption of new technologies will have a direct impact on the development of occupational standards and qualifications that are required for skilling, upskilling and reskilling the new and existing workforce at different levels. So, for example, the workforce which is coming from different parts of the world, and as well as the new workforce which is there. So they can be reskilled, upskilled, and for these kind of job roles. I'm just showing you the kind of job roles that we have got a committee which is working on Industry 4.0. Now, these are just a snapshot of the 20 job roles that we have found, which are like low-hanging fruits. Now, the one in yellow you see is something that we have already started working upon. It is under industry validation. Almost like 12 to 14 companies have validated these, which includes not just the larger companies, but also the mid-sized MSMEs. This is the rest 11 to 20th job role. Under this, we have started working on predictive maintenance engineer. This qualification has already been developed. It's with industry for industry validation. Now, apart from these skilling courses, CGC also works on World Skills Competition. And the five job, the five traits that we look after is welding, CNC turning, CNC milling, plastic die engineering, and mechanical CAD. So among these, if we see the for the last year's competition that have happened in Kazan, Russia, so one of our candidates won medallion of excellence. I'm happy to share that one of our candidates from Kerala, Francis Lijo, he was from HMT Kochi. So he was the runner-up for CNC turning in the final. I believe his job got loosened up because of he lost it. But otherwise, he was a very good candidate. And I, with him, when I talked to him, we thought there is a lot of potential. Apart from world skills, what we like to focus on is apprenticeship and national apprenticeship promotion scheme also, which is coming up. So this is again another area which is like opening up, wherein students can get trained, or the say trained students can find a further up training into the industry. Now, why industry will employ you? Because there is a mandatory requirement wherein any industry which has got more than 30 employees, either on contract or on role, they have to take at least 2.5% to 15% of the workforce as an apprenticeship. Now, the apprenticeship has changed a lot from what it was earlier and what it is currently now. The apprenticeship can earlier the apprenticeship was only for the manufacturing sector and back to on designated trades. Now apprenticeship has opened up for optional trades, which is like the courses that I have shown you in my previous slide. They can be taken up by the industry. The students can get enrolled themselves on the national portal which is there. As well as in case if industry is there, is attending the seminar, so they can adapt these courses, as well as they can define their own courses and can approach us for getting them approved. Now, I'm just showing you some of the training partners, training centers that we have in Kerala. So we have got about 50 affiliated training centers within Kerala. Now, some of the training partners with one or more of the centers are like Don Bosco, Ernakulam, then Aram Technologies is there, LaborNet Services is there, NTTF is there, PCF City is there, then SDS Kochi is there, SMEC Automation is there, and then we are working with different government ITIs under ASAP. Now, among these, why I have highlighted them in the NTTF in red is because NTTF Kannur happens to be one of our center of excellence for machining and tool and die engineering. Now, why I included this slide was just to show you the broad occupation-wise data of the workforce that we have done since beginning. So among this, if you will see the fitting and fabrication, which also includes welding and fitting, is the has the major share, which is about 39%, followed by cutting, welding, which is about 21%. The next one being designing, which is being very popular in Kerala. So ASAP, we do a lot of draftsmen and other courses. Similarly, machining is there, which is 15%. So if you see this pie chart, so this is the kind of certified workforce and the kind of employment requirement which is there within the industry. Shalini, would you like to take this? Okay, Capital Goods Skill Council also partnered with C.V. Raman University, wherein Fronius, IAW and Lincoln were also partnered to it, wherein we worked on the advanced welding, this national welding competition for women. So the welding is not just a men's role anymore. So women have also started taking interest from, say, the short-term training course to the diploma, ITIs, as well as in the engineering. So the welding has come up as a very prominent role for women also. So within this competition, 121 women welders participated from 19 institutes across 7 states. Actually, the competition was very nice to see. And it was good to see the being a mechanical engineer, we have never seen women in taking up welding or mechanical engineering, but things are changing now. So for women also, welding has come up to be a prominent role. Over to you, Shalini.
Yeah, thank you so much, Nirbhay. So I would say that, you know, one point I want to make over here is that we touched upon a little on the Industry 4.0. A lot of people is saying that, you know, this coming of Industry 4.0 will take a lot of jobs. But I think this is a misconception, because reason being, when you say that Industry 4.0, it includes huge data to be managed. Now, for this data to be managed and, you know, working on that software, so you require people to do that. So there is definitely going to be a revamp of job roles, but Industry 4.0 is not going to take jobs all from the organizations. So this is one topic which we would also like to take it separately with all of you in detailing in terms of what are the future job roles in the Industry 4.0. So I would request Kerala government, if in case we can, you know, take a separate session on future job roles on Industry 4.0, point number one. Another thing which I would like to share was that we have just shared the list of training partners, a few training partners in Kerala. And students who are interested to opt for any job role, they can reach out to these training centers through the Kerala government and understand what are these job roles. All these job roles are also listed on our website, cgse.in. So you can Google through and understand what is this qualifications is all about. And you would also see that, you know, if you look at the entire thing, we have the maximum welding coming up. So there are a lot of aspirants who have joined welding as in skill, and also there's a lot of demand in the industry. Though it's not an easy job, it's not an office job, it requires a lot of working in heat and doing it, but there are a lot of welders required internationally also. Now coming to the people who are coming from Gulf, you know, Kerala is main where a lot of migrants will be coming from the Gulf. So there's a lot of problems that as issues which has been addressed by Mr. Pino TV, that, you know, these people needs to be reskilled and upskilled. So I would also request that, you know, we can work together in making upskilling and reskilling courses for these new workers who are coming in to revamp the entire, new jobs that we can come in. Now, I would also request my colleague, Mr. Ashish, and who can just take it over to the welding occupation, how we'll pick up one job role, which is the biggest job role as welding. And, you know, Fronius people will talk about more about welding, more about, you know, how the welding happens, what are the career prospects, and how the people can make career in the welding occupation. Over to you, Ashish, and over to you, Jinesh.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Shalini ma'am, and thank you to the entire team of Capital Goods Sector Council. And good morning and suprabhatam from my side. This is Ashish Apre. I am based out of Delhi NCR, and responsible for segment management of railways and defense and other new businesses. So we had a wonderful talk from us, the council also, and the team from ASAP, Dr. Jaikiran and Mr. Vinod. Thanks for all the inspiring words. And I have my colleague Jinesh, who is very keen to share his experiences from the industry and from various backgrounds. And I guess he belongs to the northern part of Kerala. And then after that, we have my colleague Sasi Anand, who will be taking us to the wonderful journey into this welding, what all it offers, what all challenges, how people can really upskill their things. And when Dr. Jaikiran was mentioning, there is a lot of people who are planning to rather have come back from the oil rich economies of the Gulf, and now they're looking for this thing. So that is where, you know, area where we have a forte, and we can really upskill the people for the next generation. And so we want to, you know, reduce the skill gap. Like these people going to the industry, so they should be aware of all the technologies available. So over to Jinesh, and let's look for a wonderful session ahead. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Ashish sir, and thank you SAP and CGSC for giving me this opportunity to talk in this forum. So ellarku namaskaram, ente pere Jinesh, Kannur swadeshiyanu. Enikku ente bhasha kekkumbodhu manasilayittundavum. Appo njan Pronius കമ്പനിയിലാണ് വർക്ക് ചെയ്യുന്നത്, പ്രോണിയസ് ബാംഗ്ലൂർ. അപ്പോൾ ഇപ്പോൾ ലോക്ക്ഡൗൺ ആയതുകൊണ്ട് ഞാനിപ്പോൾ നാട്ടിലാണെന്ന് കണ്ടുകൊണ്ടാണ് സംസാരിക്കുന്നത്. അപ്പോൾ ബേസിക്കലി പ്രോണിയസ് വെൽഡിംഗ് മെഷീൻസ് മാനുഫാക്ചർ ചെയ്യുന്ന, അപ്പോൾ സൊല്യൂഷൻ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ കംപ്ലീറ്റ് ജോബ് സ്റ്റഡി, പിന്നെ പ്രോസസ് റെക്കമെൻഡേഷൻ, മെഷീൻ സപ്ലൈ, ട്രയൽസ് ആൻഡ് പ്രൂവോട്ട്, അങ്ങനെ ഒരു കംപ്ലീറ്റ് വെൽഡിംഗ് സൊല്യൂഷൻ ആണ് വെൽഡിംഗ്. ബാക്ക്ഗ്രൗണ്ട്, എൻ്റെ ബാക്ക്ഗ്രൗണ്ട് പറയുകയാണെങ്കിൽ, ഞാൻ നാട്ടിലാണ് പ്ലസ് ടു പഠിച്ചത്, സാധാരണ ഗവൺമെൻറ് സ്കൂളാണ് ഞാൻ പഠിച്ചത്. അത് കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് പിന്നെ ഞാൻ NTTF മെക്കാട്രോണിക്സ് ഡിപ്ലോമ ആയിരുന്നു തമിഴ്നാട്ടിൽ. പിന്നെ അത് കഴിഞ്ഞ് ഒരു ലാസ്റ്റ് ഒരു 15 ഐടി ഫീൽഡിൽ വർക്ക് ചെയ്തു. അപ്പോൾ നിങ്ങൾ വിചാരിക്കുന്നുണ്ടാവും മെക്കാട്രോണിക്സ് പഠിച്ചത്, അത് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഈ സെഷൻ കഴിയുമ്പോൾ മനസ്സിലാകാതെ എന്തൊക്കെ ഓപ്പർച്യൂണിറ്റീസ് ആണുള്ളത്, ഏതൊക്കെ ഞാൻ പറയാൻ കാരണം, നമ്മൾ കോമൺ ആയിട്ട് ഇപ്പോൾ നമ്മുടെ നാട്ടിൽ സ്റ്റുഡൻസിനായാലും അല്ലെങ്കിൽ പൊതുവായിട്ട് പറഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ വെൽഡിംഗ് എന്ന് പറയുമ്പോൾ എല്ലാവരും ഒരു എന്താ പറയുക, നമ്മുടെ നാട്ടിൽ സാധാരണ കാണുന്ന അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഫാബ്രിക്കേഷൻ കാരണം, പിന്നെ അതിൻ്റെ ഒരു മെയിനായിട്ടുള്ള കാരണം എന്താണെന്ന് വെച്ചാൽ, നമുക്ക് ഈ വെൽഡിംഗ് ഇൻഡസ്ട്രി ആയിട്ട് അത്ര എക്സ്പോഷ്യർ കിട്ടുന്നുണ്ട്. മെയിനായിട്ട് കേരളത്തിൽ, മറ്റ് സ്റ്റേറ്റിനെ അപേക്ഷിച്ച് കേരളത്തിൽ നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ നമുക്ക് ആ വെൽഡിംഗ് ഇൻഡസ്ട്രി ആയിട്ട് അത്ര ഒരു എക്സ്പോഷ്യർ കിട്ടും. മെയിനായിട്ട് ഇൻഡസ്ട്രീസ് കുറവാണെന്നുള്ളത് തന്നെയാണ് അതിൻ്റെ കാരണം. പിന്നെ അതുകൂടാണ്ട് നമ്മൾ കോളേജസ് ആയാലും പ്രൊഫഷണൽ കോളേജ് ആയാലും സാധാരണ കോളേജ് വെൽഡിങ്ങിന് അത്രമാത്രം ഒരു ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻസ് എവിടെയും കൊടുക്കുന്നില്ല. വെൽഡിംഗ് ജോബ് ഒരു പഴയ മോഡൽ മെഷീൻസ് ആണ് മിക്കവാറും വെൽഡിംഗ് ലാബിൽ ഉപയോഗിക്കുന്നത്. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് വെൽഡിംഗ് പ്രാക്ടിക്കൽ സെക്ഷൻ ജസ്റ്റ് ഒരു വെൽഡിംഗ് റോഡ് തരും, സ്ക്രാപ്പ് ലൈറ്റ് തരും, നാലഞ്ച് പ്രാവശ്യം വെൽഡ് ചെയ്യാൻ കഴിയും. അപ്പോൾ അത് ചെയ്യുന്ന സ്റ്റുഡൻസ് ആയാലും അവർക്ക് അത് വെൽഡിങ്ങിനെ പറ്റിയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു ധാരണ അതിനായിരിക്കും. ഇതിനാണ് അങ്ങനൊരു ധാരണ മൊത്തത്തിൽ വരുന്നുണ്ട്. ഞാനും എന്നെ ഞാൻ പഠിക്കുന്ന കാലത്ത് അങ്ങനെ തന്നെയായിരുന്നു. അപ്പോൾ വെൽഡിംഗ് ഫീൽഡിൽ വന്നതിന് ശേഷമാണ് വെൽഡിംഗ് അത്രമാത്രം അഡ്വാൻസ് ആയിട്ട്, ഇപ്പം നമ്മൾ സാധാരണ നാട്ടിൽ കാണുന്ന വെൽഡിംഗ് ചെയ്യാനൊരു സ്കില്ലൊന്നും ആവശ്യമില്ല. ഏതൊരു അൺസ്കിൽഡ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ആൾക്കാർക്കും അത് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റും. അപ്പോൾ റിയൽ ആയിട്ട് ഒരു വെൽഡിംഗ് ഇൻഡസ്ട്രിയിൽ വന്ന് വെൽഡ് ചെയ്യുകയാണെങ്കിൽ അത് പ്രത്യേക സ്കിൽ ആവശ്യമാണ്. നമ്മൾ ഈ കാണുന്ന വെൽഡിംഗ് ഒന്നല്ല, മെയിനായിട്ട് ഒരു ഫോക്കസ് ഇൻഡസ്ട്രിയിൽ നമ്മൾ വെൽഡിംഗ് നോക്കുമ്പോൾ ഉണ്ടാവുള്ളത്. അപ്പോൾ കേരളത്തിൽ ഇപ്പൊ ഒരു എക്സാമ്പിൾ പറയുകയാണെങ്കിൽ, നമുക്കറിയാം PSLV റോക്കറ്റ് ലോഞ്ച് ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ അതിൽ എത്രമാത്രം വെൽഡിംഗ് ഇൻവോൾവ് ആയിട്ട് PSSC നമ്മുടെ തിരുവനന്തപുരത്ത് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ബ്രഹ്മോസ് എയ്റോസ്പേസ് വെൽഡിംഗ് ആണ് അത് ചെയ്യാൻ, അത്രമാത്രം ഓപ്പറേറ്റർക്ക് എത്ര സ്കിൽ ആവശ്യമുണ്ട്. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് ഇപ്പൊ നമ്മൾ വെൽഡിങ്ങിൽ തന്നെ ഉപയോഗിക്കുന്ന ലേറ്റസ്റ്റ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള മെഷീൻസ് എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് ഒരു കമ്പ്യൂട്ടർ ബേസ്ഡ് വെൽഡിംഗ് മെഷീൻസ് ആണെങ്കിലും അത് ഓപ്പറേറ്റ് ചെയ്യണമെങ്കിലും നമുക്കൊരു സ്കിൽ ആവശ്യമാണ്. ഒരു ബേസിക് ആയിട്ടുള്ള നോളജ് ലെവലും ഒരു സ്കില്ലുണ്ടെങ്കിലും മാത്രം അത് ഓപ്പറേറ്റ് ചെയ്യണമെങ്കിലും അപ്പോ വെൽഡിംഗ് ഫീൽഡില് നമുക്ക് ഇന്ത്യയിലെ ഇൻഡസ്ട്രി നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ സ്കില്ല് ഷോർട്ടേജ് ഓൾ ഓവർ ഇന്ത്യ എല്ലാ സ്ഥലത്തും ഉണ്ട്. നമ്മൾ കേരളത്തിലെ ഇൻഡസ്ട്രി മാത്രം നോക്കുകയാണെങ്കിൽ അങ്ങനെ കുറച്ച് ഇൻഡസ്ട്രി മാത്രമേ ഉള്ളൂ. പക്ഷെ കേരളത്തിന്റെ പുറത്ത്, അതായത് ഇപ്പോൾ ബാംഗ്ലൂർ ആണെങ്കിലും ചെന്നൈ തമിഴ്നാട് എവിടെ ആണെങ്കിലും ഓട്ടോമൊബൈൽ ഇൻഡസ്ട്രി ആണെങ്കിലും എയറോസ്പേസ് ആണെങ്കിലും ഷിപ്പിലിംഗ് അങ്ങനെ ഏത് ഇൻഡസ്ട്രി സെഗ്മെന്റ് എടുത്തു കഴിഞ്ഞാലും വെൽഡിംഗ് ഒരു പോർ ഏരിയ തന്നെയാണ്. അപ്പോൾ ആ ഇൻഡസ്ട്രിയിൽ ഒരു വെൽഡർക്ക് അത്രമാത്രം ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻസ്. അപ്പോൾ ആ വെൽഡിംഗ് ചെയ്യാൻ ആ സ്കില്ല് നമുക്ക് എക്വയർ ചെയ്യണമെങ്കിൽ നമുക്ക് നോർമലി പഠിക്കുന്ന കോളേജ് അക്കാഡമിക്സിൽ പഠിക്കുന്നത് അവിടെ നിന്ന് നമുക്കൊന്ന് സ്കില്ല് അക്വയർ ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റും. അതായത് നമുക്ക് അതിനു വേണ്ടിയിട്ട് ഒരു സെൻറ്റർ ഓഫ് എക്സലൻസ് മോഡേൺ എന്താ പറയുക വെൽഡിംഗ് മെഷീനായിട്ട് നമുക്കൊരു എക്സ്പോഷർ കിട്ടും. റോബോട്ടിക് വെൽഡിംഗ് നമുക്ക് അതിന് ഹാൻഡ്സ് ഓൺ എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ് ഉണ്ട്. ഈ കാര്യങ്ങളൊക്കെ ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ഏതൊരു ഇൻഡസ്ട്രി ജോബ് സെക്യൂരിറ്റി ഉണ്ട്. അതായത് ഇപ്പോൾ ഓൾറെഡി ഹ്യൂജ് ഷോർട്ടേജ് ഓഫ് സ്കിൽ ലേബർ എല്ലാ ഇൻഡസ്ട്രി നോക്കിക്കഴിഞ്ഞാലും എസ്പെഷ്യലി വെൽഡിംഗ് വെരി ഹ്യൂജ് സ്കിൽ ഷോർട്ടേജ്. സോ അപ്പോൾ നമ്മൾ ഫ്രോണിയർ സൈഡിൽ നമ്മൾ മെയിനായിട്ട് ചെയ്യുന്നത് സ്റ്റുഡൻസിന് ന്യൂ യങ് യൂത്തിന് കൊളാബറേഷൻ വിത്ത് എഡ്യൂക്കേഷൻ ഇൻസ്റ്റിറ്റ്യൂട്ട് നമ്മൾ ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. അതുകൊണ്ട് നമ്മൾ റോബോട്ടിക് ലേറ്റസ്റ്റ് ടെക്നോളജി വെൽഡിംഗ് മെഷീൻസ് ഇൻസ്റ്റാൾ ചെയ്തിട്ട് അവിടെ ഹാൻഡ്സ് ഓൺ എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റും. അപ്പോൾ ഇപ്പോൾ നോക്കിക്കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ നമ്മൾ ഓട്ടോമോട്ടീവ് സെഗ്മെൻ്റ് തന്നെ ഫോർ എക്സാമ്പിൾ ടി വി എസ് ആയാലും ഹോണ്ട അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ബജാജ് അവരൊക്കെ ഹൺഡ്രഡ്സ് ഓഫ് റോബോട്ട്സ് ഈവൺ മോർ 500-600 റോബോട്ടിക് മെഷീൻസ് വെൽഡിംഗ് മെഷീൻസ് വർക്ക് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ ആ റോബോട്ടിക് വെൽഡിംഗ് മെഷീൻ ഓപ്പറേറ്റ് ചെയ്യണമെങ്കിൽ ഒരു സ്കിൽ ആയിട്ടുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ ഒരു നോർമൽ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരാളെ നമ്മൾ റിക്രൂട്ട് ചെയ്ത് ആ റോബോട്ടിക് പ്രൊഡക്ഷൻ റൺ ചെയ്യണം എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ നമുക്ക് ആ ക്വാളിറ്റി അച്ചീവ് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റില്ല, പ്രൊഡക്ടിവിറ്റി അച്ചീവ് ചെയ്യണം, ടൈമിന് നമുക്ക് പ്രൊഡ്യൂസ് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റില്ല. അപ്പോൾ നമ്മൾ ഈ ഓൾറെഡി ഈ സ്കില്ല് നമ്മൾ അക്യൂർ ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ നമുക്ക് ലോട്ട് ഓഫ് ഓപ്പർച്യൂണിറ്റി. അപ്പോൾ നമ്മൾ വെൽഡിങ്ങിൻ്റെ മെയിൻ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു പെർസെപ്ഷൻ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ വെൽഡിംഗ് നമ്മൾ ഈ കാണുന്ന ഈ മുഖം വെച്ച് ആയിട്ടുള്ള വെൽഡിംഗ് ആണുള്ളത് അത് നമ്മൾ മൊത്തത്തിൽ ചേഞ്ച് ചെയ്യണം. കാരണം വെൽഡിംഗ് ഇൻഡസ്ട്രിയിൽ പഠിക്കുന്ന വെൽഡേഴ്സിന് നമ്മൾ ജോയിനിങ് സ്പെഷ്യലിസ്റ്റ് എന്നാണ് ഒരുപാട് വാല്യൂ വെൽഡേഴ്സ് വെൽഡിംഗ് ചെയ്യാൻ അറിയണം. അതേപോലെ വെൽഡിംഗ് ഏതൊരു ഇൻഡസ്ട്രീൻ്റെയും കോർ ആക്ടിവിറ്റിയാണ്. അപ്പോൾ നമ്മൾ ഈ സെഷനിൽ മെയിനായിട്ട് കവർ ചെയ്യാൻ ഉദ്ദേശിക്കുന്നത് വെൽഡിങ്ങിൽ നമുക്ക് ഏതൊക്കെ ഓപ്പർച്യൂണിറ്റി ഉണ്ട്, എവിടെയൊക്കെ നമുക്ക് അതിനുള്ള സ്കില്ല് ആക്വയർ ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ നമുക്ക് ഇതിനൊക്കെ നേടാൻ പറ്റും. അതേപോലെ തന്നെ നമുക്കിപ്പോൾ ഒരു വെൽഡേഴ്സ് അത്ര ഒരു തരന്താണ് ഒരു ഇതായിട്ടാണ് നോർമലായിട്ട് നമ്മുടെ നാട്ടിലൊക്കെ പറയും. പക്ഷേ ആക്ച്വൽ ഒരു വെൽഡിംഗ് ഫീൽഡിൽ പോയി കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ നമുക്ക് മനസ്സിലാവും ഒരു നോർമൽ ഒരു എന്താ പറയുക ന്യൂക്ലിയർ സെക്ടറിൽ വെൽഡ് ചെയ്യുന്ന ഒരാൾ എനിക്ക് പരിചയമുള്ള 100,000 രൂപയാണല്ല മാസ ശമ്പളമാണ്. നിങ്ങളൊരു സ്കിൽ അക്വയർ ചെയ്ത് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ അതിനാണ് കയറ്റി. അപ്പോൾ ഇന്നത്തെ സെക്ഷൻ ഇവിടെ കണ്ടക്ട് ചെയ്യാമെന്ന് സീനിയർ ആയിട്ടുള്ള സാറാണ് ശശിയാനന്ദ് സാർ. സാറ് മെയിനായിട്ട് ഇംഗ്ലീഷിലാണ് ഈ ടോപ്പിക് പ്രസന്റ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. അപ്പോൾ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് എന്തെങ്കിലും ഡൗട്ട് ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ നിങ്ങൾ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഏരിയയിൽ ടൈപ്പ് ചെയ്യാം. കരിയർ അഡ്വൈസ് വേണമെങ്കിൽ പേഴ്സണലായിട്ട് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് മെസ്സേജ് ചെയ്യാം. അല്ലാതെ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ആയാലും മനസ്സിലാക്കാനും ബുദ്ധിമുട്ടുന്നുണ്ടാകും, നമുക്ക് ഏത് ഭാഷയിൽ പറഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞാലും കാര്യങ്ങൾ മനസ്സിലാവും. അപ്പോൾ എന്തെങ്കിലും ഡൗട്ട് ഉണ്ടെങ്കിൽ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ ഏരിയയിൽ ചോദിക്കുക. അതായത് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് പ്രത്യേകമായിട്ട് ഒരു സെഷനിൽ എക്സ്ക്ലൂസീവ് ആയിട്ട് മലയാളത്തിൽ വേണമെങ്കിൽ അത് ഫ്യൂച്ചറിൽ നമുക്ക് കൺസൾട്ട് ചെയ്യാം. അപ്പോൾ നമുക്ക് ടൈം വേസ്റ്റ് ആക്കാണ്ട് ടോപ്പിക്കിലേക്ക് പോകാം. സാർ ഓവർ ടു യു സാർ. ശശി സാർ
ജസ്റ്റ് താങ്ക് യു. ജിനേഷ് ബിഫോർ ശശി സാർ ടേക്സ് ഓവർ, I would just like to again share that in case of any question and questions where participants have, they can always put it in the question answer area, and we will try to answer some questions in the during the session if possible, and then if not answered then we will definitely answer at the end of the session. But be assured all the questions will be answered to any of the subjects, any of the topics. And thank you Jinesh for taking us through this wonderful life of a person from mechatronics background then coming to welding and all. And over to my colleague Sasyanand Parsarthi, who will be taking us for the entire choosing welding as a career. Over to you Sasyanand.
Good morning to all. Thank you, Ashish. Thank you, Jinesh. Thank you, Dr. Jaikiran sir, for your wonderful opening statements. And I hope I'm audible to you all, and you are able to see my first screen. Let's be informed building as a career. Someone of you can acknowledge so that I will keep moving.
Yeah, so see, it's visible to me.
Thank you. I'm not actually switching on the video. I will switch off the video now because of the bandwidth issues. I will straight away have my screen on, and also my audio will be reaching you all hopefully in a better way based on the internet connections. So I will switch off my video. I'll be on in the audio and also onto the screens in the form of the PPT. Yeah, so I will now switch off the video, and I will go ahead with the presentation and the topic of the day, welding as a career. So this is what is my topic. So I will move on to the slides, which is there onto your screens now, which is actually the career of welding, which is an untold success story, which as Fronius, we would like to share with you. And this is going to be the first step for the bright future, what is going to be there for the entire student community and also the welding fraternity, the welding professionals who are there in this presentation. And I would like to take you through this journey, and hopefully I think I will be able to keep it interesting to you all. So moving on to my next slide, wherein you can see onto your screens now, where I am actually introducing you as a form of art. Welding is also a science, but I would always say that welding is an art. And you can see a flower, which is actually made out of a titanium pillar alloy. This, I took it from the Patent Institute Kyiv, which is in Ukraine, where one of the technician has actually used the titanium pillar alloy and made this flower, which is actually made out of a manual method by a process which is called as TIG welding, which you all know, which is actually called as the gas tungsten arc welding process. So now I'd like to start welding with the form of an art. And it is not just joining, because there are many people who know that the definition of welding is a process where you have to join metals or maybe even non-metals to form a coalescence, and then you form a solid union between the two materials which are going to be there. But now I would like to introduce you that welding is an art, and this is one of the pieces which is there in front of your screens. I will move on to the next slide, where it will be very more interesting to you, where you can see the various forms of the weld arts, which you can see onto your screens, which is there displayed, which is a peacock, a lion, a horse, and a fish. And you can see the various components which are actually welded. So basically, welds are very critical to the integrity of any fabrication which is involving the materials or the metals to be joined, which is what you are seeing in your screens now. This is made by some of the artists, welding artists, who are all highly qualified to the level of even post-graduation, who are using these welding power sources of Fronius for making such arts. And India, this art form is picking up a lot, because this is going to be in the form of an garden art, or it can be even in some kind of the sculptures which are kept in ornamental ways in many areas. And this is actually picking up now in India. It is actually there in the metal fabrication artist form by various Americans and Russians who have already there. I cannot name them because it's a long list, where there are, you can also find out from various forms of internet, where there are various metal fabrication artists who actually make it as an art form. And from this, what I would like to tell you in the slide is, welding is actually an art, and it requires a very high degree of skill and commitment to this job. What I would like to tell you more is, you also require a very high patience, very good focus, and your eyesight are also a part of your welder's toolbox. I would like to tell you that this is going to be a very, very important part, which is going to be there, which is required for as a welders toolbox, and we don't want to call welders, we want to actually call them as joining specialists. So the joining specialists are going to be the key for the nation building, and you can also see this form of the Master of Art forms. So this is to start with my presentation, and we will move on to the next slide onto your screens, where you can see what is conventional welding. So you can see various images onto your screens where there is a technician who is doing a welding joining of a structural steel, somebody doing a repair of a motorbike, somebody making a grill. These are all the common sights what makes you feel that this is what is welding, but it is not so. This is a basic welding, this is a conventional welding form, and this is actually requiring basically lesser skills than that of the skill of the structural steel welding or a structural welding, which I will actually move on to the next slide with the definition of welding, which is nothing but a process where you have to join metals with the application. I will also call not only metals, because now we are into the field of joining of metals. I want to tell it is metals. You can also join non-materials, non-metals also, like plastic, with the application of heat, without or with the application of pressure, because there are various forms of welding wherein you have resistance welding, you have the various forms of welding which requires pressure, which is the forge welding, and that was the invention which started in the very beginning with the longer days. And then you also require a filler, which you can actually see the various kind of applications where fabrication is being done to form an unison that is nothing but a metallurgical joint. So basically, welding is the process of joining to have a structural integrity so that the materials are getting united. Basically, I would actually call welding is nothing but a coalescence of materials. So this is one important aspect of what you would like to know about welding, which involves heat, which involves pressure, which involves the major important form is the filler, and you also require a very important aspect of the welding power source. Okay, moving on to the next slide. Why welding is important? So now we saw what is welding. We also have to know why it is important, because you know that every day in, day out, you know that pipelines which brings fresh water has to be joined. You also have all these towers which are transmitting electricity, which you know that these are all to be welded. These are all galvanized materials. It has to be welded. You know what is the issues which are coming up in welding these kind of structural components. So you have to be very careful in understanding welding. Then comes to the cars and buses, automotive industries, which are the major chunk of industries which are using the robotic welding processes. Each and every car manufacturer produces around 600 to 700 cars per day, and you require welding. So welding is going to be there, which is there, which are there surrounded by us in various forms. So this is why I feel that welding is going to be very, very important aspect of the industry forms of joining. So what is the importance? It attached to the manufacturing, because in the very beginning of our discussion, even Dr. Jay Karan sir told, and our managing director was also telling about the importance of the manufacturing sector. So welding is bringing a big impact to the manufacturing, because welding plays a key role in this actually challenge. How it is, you can see here, welding contributes to, you can see onto your slides, the heavy manufacturing, the pressure vessels. Then comes the light manufacturing, the small and medium enterprises. Then comes the construction, where you can see the various constructions, scaffoldings. There are many industries which are manufacturing scaffoldings in and around Kerala. They are actually using the materials like aluminium for making this scaffolding. And joining of aluminium is furthermore tedious, and we require people for making these scaffoldings or maybe these structures which are there on your street. So welding is used in these areas of construction, which is also a major part of the requirement. Then comes the transportation sector. You can see here the slide where you have the aeroplane, the metro coach, be it space or be it at the sea, the bottom of the sea, the submarines. You have welding, which is very, very key, which is going to be the very important role in the future. Without welding, I would say that we will all be going back to the Stone Age. So welding is going to be the very, very important key aspect in the particular transportation sector. And I would also take you to one more sector, which is nothing but the maintenance and repair sector. For example, in Kerala, if I want to talk about the maintenance repairs, you have the Malabar Cements, you have the Travancore Cements, you have the Kerala Minerals and Metals Corporation, you have the ISRO, which are actually using in a great way, and we are also a part of. I'll show you the later part about where all it is being used. I would only say that this is another field of welding, which is called as repair and maintenance welding. You have sugar mills, wherein you are able to see a roller which is getting arced. In near to close to Palakkad, there are sugar mills which are actually using these kind of rollers. So maintenance and repair welding is a big field wherein we require the welders to play a very, very important role. So coming to the last but not the least, the power sector. Though we don't have much of power sector, which is the fossil fuel power sector, but there are huge amount of idle power sectors in Kerala. And to my experience, I have visited many of the idle power stations of Kerala, where there are huge Pelton turbines, huge components which are of straight chrome alloys, which has to be welded. So this is another area which has to be focused. So I would only give you certain key industry segments. Maybe we will talk about these segments in the next few slides also. So moving on to the important side, which is onto the screen. So our Prime Minister has also started the initiative of Make in India, and to a greater extent, I think the Skill India is also being done, and welding is an important skill, and we have to be skilled in this particular sector so that the manufacturing industry is also getting the benefits. And you can also have very many other industries which are there, which I will talk about that in the consecutive slides, in the next slides. So what is required now? The technology is very, very important. You need the right technology for the particular kind of the welding, and you require an innovation, and you also require skill. So these three things only will make you to make a component which has to be made in India in a perfect way. So this is one very important aspect which we have to know. So the technology can be provided by Fronius. The innovation has to come from the people, and the skill has to be provided by us, so that you will be able to be having the very good combination of these mix of qualities, and we'll be able to make in India. Certainly, undoubtedly, we will. Kerala will also play a major role in this kind of Make in India concept. Yeah. Moving on to the next slides. I would like to talk about the challenges first, which are very, very important. What is there in the challenging environments? You can see very clearly onto the slides now the greatest challenge which is there, which is the skill shortage. Next to Japan, India has a shortage of more than 64%. This is the statistics which is taken in the year 2014, but still now I think it will be valid. It will not be changing much. So what I would like to tell you is there's a skill shortage which is expected. With more than, this study was done with more than 10 or more employees in the selected country, where you can see the developed countries like Spain, UK, France, China are all having a low shortage, because they are all very well skilled. Skills plays a major role in these countries, and when we increase the skill, we will be able to increase the manufacturing sector, and we will be able to talk about this $5 trillion economy and things like that. Which will not be discussed now, because the student community has to understand that the skill is going to be the key in the future. So there is a dearth of skill, and welding is one of the skill which is facing a dearth, and we would be playing a major role in improvising the skills, and we would like to actually give an importance to the skill as a welding. Moving on to the next slide, the manufacturing challenge, where you can see the very important key features. By 2022, India will be needing around 119 million additional skilled workforce. This is the government report. This is not our statistics. You can see the statistics of 2022, but still now we are not equipping ourselves. Then it will be going to be a difficult target again. And if we don't address these skill issues, our economy will have to face a serious decline. That is what, which will not happen, but this is one of the statements by the Manufacturing Institute president. And you can also see in front of your screens that the manufacturers will need as many as 10 million new skill sets, new skills, and also the skilled workers by 2020, so that the aging economy of the skills will actually be filled up when we actually have better skills. And 81% of the manufacturers polled by the NAM and Deloitte report say that the skilled workers will only keep the business competitive. This is what is the Manufacturing Institute Vice President's statement. So this is what makes us to understand that skill is going to be the key role in the future. So that is what I would like to tell you in this slide, and I will move on to the next challenge, which is the welding challenge, which is there because the welding industry itself is a 6,000 crore in Indian rupee industry. The welding industry itself is a 6,000 crore industry. I am actually not only talking about the equipments here, I am talking about the entire gamut of the welding products, including the fillers, including the entire materials like your cutting equipments, your filling fillers, that is your electrodes, wire electrodes, all those things put together. It is a big industry as such. And the average age of the welding industry is actually there. It is very clearly understood that it is more than 40 plus. So what I would suggest is the younger generation has to come forward and we would actually get the skill of welding. So it is estimated that there will be a shortage of 20,000 plus skilled workforce in the welding industry by end of 2020. So this is the shortage which was pre-COVID, and now as already Dr. Jaikiran has told that there is a huge migration of the welding technicians, welding professionals from abroad. So this also will contribute that the shortage is going to be really going up, and this is going to be there at the end of this 2020, will be added up only. And industries are already looking after, looking for the skilled people. Day in and day out, we are getting calls from various industries that we need skilled welders. And industries are hiring skilled people from abroad. You will not believe that there are many people who are there in the higher up, in the higher management of various organizations. There are the expats who are actually the skilled welding professionals from abroad to carry out the welding jobs. So we need to actually have to fill up these gaps, and we will be able to meet out these challenges. I'm very sure that Kerala will actually play a major role in actually bridging this gap of meeting the welding industry challenges. Okay, moving on to my next slide. I hope I have made some clarity, and I will move on to the next slide. The need actually grows. The need grows because the entire manufacturing technology itself gets changed. No matter that we will be welding with a, I will give an example of welding with a transformer. Days are gone. We have very, very advanced technologies which have come in place, and the entire the steel material itself has got a lot of changes. It has been evolved. Like, for example, we want to reduce the weight of the automotive. Earlier, we were using carbon steel in the automotive. But today, I don't know how many of you are able to see the advertisement. Hyundai gives an advertisement mentioning that we use AHSS. That means that they are using an advanced high-strength steel. So people have to be having a knowledge on these materials so that they will be able to weld this in a very, very easier methodology. So the welding technology itself is getting a huge change, and there is a very, very high importance for the certification. For example, I'll give an example of an industry which is the railway sector, which actually requires a standard which is IS 15085, and you require welders to be trained in IS 3834, or you require a welder who has IS 9606-1. So how to do this? Where we will have to do this bridging the gap? The certification. So there is very important aspect of this certification which is going to play a role, because we have to match the global standards, and certification plays an important role, and the need is actually growing on day by day. So the welders, whoever is listening, who have to go through the certification courses, there are very many ways to improve their knowledge in terms of certification courses, not only for the welders, but also for the welding professionals as such. Coming to the computer skills, we will be able to see that there are robotic programmers requirement, there are laser welders requirement. There's going to be a huge requirement, because already lasers are being used for welding. The laser hybrid is being used for welding. We will be not only restricting ourselves to the arc welding. The technology itself has gone through a sea change. The materials have gone through a sea change. And the welding automation is going to be the future. Because now, as such, we have been talking about Industry 4.0. The Industry 4.0 is nothing but having the entire equipment being controlled by a palm top. Sitting at my office, I'll be able to see what is happening to my welding machine, which is operating at my workshop, which is actually more than, I would say, millions of kilometers. Like I will be able to see what is happening at my at our factory, which is there in Austria in Belz. I will only able to type the IP number. I'll be able to see what is happening there. So this is what is Industry 4.0, and the Fronius equipments are already enabled for Industry 4.0 ready, and you can able to document the entire machine's performance, your entire details of like welding current, welding voltage, wire feed speed, heat input, everything can be captured. So that is what is the order of the day, and welding automation plays a very, very important in terms of the skilled people is required. So automation does not mean that it will reduce the number of employees. Automation will actually improve the number of employees in terms of skilled manpower is required. And I have already told you that the Indian employment of in the field of welding is actually an aging infrastructure. There are people who are 40 plus. Basically, what happens is welding, what happens is the welders are already aged, more than 40, and we would actually require the youngsters to come up, and so that we will be able to have a younger infrastructure, because India is having an younger generation population. Okay, moving on to the next slide, onto the screen. Some of the facts, please understand these facts, because these are slightly not very good to gel, but you will have to understand that people with the vocational skills are actually earning more than that of even MBAs and engineers. That is what is actually the scenario. If you have a skill, if you have the proper technology, you will be able to be paid for the skill, not for the education. And I would give a sorry state of affairs that 80% of the graduating engineers are unemployable because of lack of skills. Not only the skills in terms of soft skills, in terms of even the skills like welding, fitting, all those things are missing, which is there, which is going to be the future. And we have to get these skills to be very well empowered. And you can also see that the team lead services have indicated some of the salaries of the blue collar jobs are exceeding those of engineers, even between 10% to 20%. So you can understand that the blue collar job is nothing but the people who are having the hands-on experience are always able to get the very high importance, and the salaries are the financial power is also going to be increased when you acquire a skill, and that is what is in terms of between 10% to 27% of hike between the educated segment. Moving on to the opportunities for the youngsters, there are endless opportunities. I will like to list a few of the opportunities for the youngsters, which is there from where it is used. You can see there right from the cutlery to the automotive to the space to the underground, the underwater submarine. So these are all the areas. We have played a part in Chandrayaan. We have played a part in the nuclear submarine. All the vehicles which are running in the two-wheeler segment are all mostly welded. That is, the frames are welded by Fronius. And I would like to tell you that these are the places where we need people like the youngsters. And what do the students need? Simple. The students need the skill, the ability, the knowledge. The skill, the ability, and knowledge will only take you to these places where you will be able to have the career in terms of in your screen. This is a big list. The slide will not be enough. You can see the welding engineer, the welding technologist, welding specialist. You can become a welding inspector, welding quality control manager, a metallurgist, a welding application expert, a trainer. Welding trainers are very, very important areas they play. Welding R&D research scholars, the product marketing engineers, the robotic engineers, the welding consultant, and many, many more. I have not touched upon cutting and ND, which is another big field. The non-destructive testing, there are a lot of fields of the areas where you can grow, succeed, and you can have a career in these areas. So welding is not just the conventional form. You will be able to understand this from these areas, whatever I am actually showing up. It is only few of these I have listed out, but there are many, many more. Moving on to the next slide, where you will be able to focus on. I am already telling you the space, the sectors where you will be able to have. Kerala has got the very important aspect. Our MD has already told about the Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, and which is at Trivandrum. You also have the LPSC. You also have the LPSC at Valiamala. You also have the ISRO Inertial Systems Unit, which is not, it is at Trivandrum, which is nothing but which manufactures the R&D parts of the navigation system, the gyros.
Sir, I request you to we are running out of time. It would be good if you can wind up in one minute because we are at least.
I'm not able to get you. Hello?
Sir, I request you to wind up. We need to discuss a lot of.
Can you type it out? Your voice is actually distorted.
Please. Sir, time is up.
Hello?
Yeah.
I think this is the last Hello, line, sir.
Sir, can you hear me?
Yeah,
sure. Thank you.
So the, because of the time constraint, they wanted to go for a winding up. So I said this is one of the last slides, so we can continue immediately after.
We continue or should I?
Okay.
Yeah, I think this is the last slide. What
no,
you have?
Please,
okay. 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 Fine. So I'll actually stop here. Okay, this is the space industry where you have important areas of the space industry where you can have very many areas of applications for welding. And we have the power, we have the roads and railway, the highways, the food processing industry, the pharmaceuticals. There are many areas where you have the stainless steel welding. And in front of you, the next slide, I think I should wind up. Okay. The railways, where we have the ports, the Cochin shipyard, and also the automotive industries. There are many other defense manufacturing units also, where you have the building. Okay, so should I stop here?
Yeah, I think. Yeah, Dr. Jakiran, we have just had the last slide of potential income because many participants. We're very keen to understand. So just Shashi can please display the slide.
Yeah, yeah. Sure, sure.
Please.
Please. Please.
Please.
Yes.
Yeah. Shashi, you can just briefly tell them because many people were very too curious to know what is the finally the outcome of this.
Yeah, this is what the salaries of the welding professions I have mentioned here. Some of the welding jobs are paying as much as even 2,500 rupees per hour. And the welding annual packages can even go between 3 lakhs to 70 lakhs, depending upon the experience and the, also the skill what they have acquired, and also the certification what they have. And you can have these details about the salaries for the welding related jobs, and also the welding specialties, the experience level matters much. And there are many employers who also provide internships, and also the paid internships which are there, which actually starting from the beginners to the experience level. So this is what I want to talk about on this slide. Hope I'm done. Should I stop sharing?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Dr. Jakiran, I think Shashi is through with the most important slide of the day, which is the potential income. And anything specific slide remaining, Shashi, which we can just slide through and people can just have it. Yeah, I think that is fair enough that we have already talked about that. And so this is what we were talking about, robotics and automation. Yeah, I think we can just run through the slides.
This is the one of the glimpses welders can actually go for this training in this institute, which is the Robotic Welding Institute. Then we can have a center of excellences, which are also there. The welders can get trained in these initiatives.
You
can see that. All these initiatives. Yeah, there are many slides. I cannot have justice in showing.
Yeah.
Very, very fast. I can only go to the last slide and say a summary and join building to inspire and create a build better India.
I think thank you Shashi for this Dr. Jaikiran, we are through. There had been some questions from the participants which I have tried to answer in the panel. So over to the SAP team and Shalini ma'am and Mr. Nirbhai.
Okay. So thank you so much. Am I audible? Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you, sir.
Okay. So thank you, Shalini ma'am and Nirbhai Srivastav ji. You made a very wonderful presentation covering all aspects of capital goods sector, its length and breadth, and about the future opportunities. Now, we have listed down a series of action points. So I'll discuss all those things. And thanks to Parthasarathy for telling us that building is an art. So I was just amazed to see the titanium floor, the stocks and all, the huge startup opportunity or business incubation opportunity in that area as far as the stage is concerned. We'll discuss all those things. Before I come to the action points, let me take 2 minutes to tell you what our thrust areas are now, right, as far as skill development is concerned. So the first very important intervention from the side of additional skill acquisition program is the setting up of advanced skill development centers in engineering colleges and polytechnic of the So we are setting up 66 advanced skill development centers in engineering colleges and 45 advanced skill development centers. So we are setting up robotics labs, fab labs, all those things in these technical institutions. That's one. The community skill parks are going to be the place where we will engage with the community for equipping them on the futuristic job roles. We have advanced high-end training facilities here. So that is the second one. And the third and most important opportunity which was offered by COVID-19 is in the area of engaging with almost all sectors. Now, in fact, the additional skill acquisition program has been organizing series of such webinars with a lot of experts from different sectors. That, in fact, prompted us to start what is called a skill log. The skill log is skill dialogue. It started from yesterday, day from yesterday onwards. The idea is like involving all the government departments, sectors, including ministers and experts from other various fields like development planning and all. So we bring everyone to one skill log and we discuss about the opportunities as to where we stand, where we are going, what are the opportunities. And then we are actually consolidating all the points and converting it into an action plan. And implementing this action plan, will be closely working with the government departments. So the government departments will be taking on initiatives, different initiatives. We have startup mission, we have the NORCA, which is concerned with non-resident Keralites. So government programs are there. So that will be taken care of by them, but we'll provide them managerial support. The second and most important thing is the skill development anchors. So the skill development part of all those areas will be taken up by SAP in the skill community skill parts. So this is where we stand now. Now, coming to the presentations, I have noted down many points. So I find three major areas of engagement as far as this capital goods sector is concerned. One is engagement with the advanced skill development centers in technical institutions. So capital goods sectoral council as well as Fronius have told us about the future job roles, especially the qualification paths with the capital goods sectoral council. So we would like to, and as Shalini ma'am rightly mentioned, we are keen to hold a separate discussion on the industry 4.0 and future job roles. We'll do that. That is a priority as far as we are concerned. So that is going to be the engagement on the technical institution parts. And the second one is regarding the return migrants. There we'll go for upskilling programs and especially in the area of welding. We have a lot of welders spread across the state doing welding all through the years without any training or certification. And some of them, I'm sure, they are master welders. So there is huge opportunity for RPL as far as upskilling them. And also, I got some idea as to we need accredited welding production come skill training centers. We need to set up some chain of them in the state. So we would request Capital Goods Sector Skill Council to think about that as well, so that we can have standards as far as this is concerned. And when it comes to community skill park, there are forward linkage opportunities. We are going to focus on forward linkages as far as the community skill parks are concerned. Here we'll do internship. Just give me a second. I'll just come back. So there we have we are going to focus on forward linkages in the community skill parks in terms of internships, apprenticeships, long duration training, or industry familiarization, and offering startup. In fact, we are also recently started engaging with the University of Southampton, which has got expertise in business incubation, and also the India Business Group based in UK. So preliminary discussions have already been completed, and we are planning to establish a business incubation lab in one of our community skill parks. So there we are going to think about all these things, ending up to startups. So that is something which I wanted to tell you. So this, I would like to sum up by telling you that we would engage with the Capital Goods Sector Skill Council and I'm sorry, I forgot the name. So Fronium in the area of advanced skill development by introducing futuristic courses in engineering colleges and polytechnics, that is one. Second, as far as community skilling is concerned, we will also focus on return migrants for equipping them in all the very important job roles which are going to become very relevant in the post-COVID world. So we have already started segregating this population, return migrant population, based on their skills profile, based on their aspiration, interests, and all those things. So soon we'll have a huge data with us. So we'll work with the Capital Goods Sector Skill Council and Fronium as far as how we can engage with this community for equipping them for the future and helping them migrate to within the country as well as outside the country in very promising areas. And that is one. And the last one, last point I would like to tell you is that regarding the Rebuild Kerala, because now we are facing the issue of repeated disasters, natural disasters. The state has got a program called Rebuild Kerala, where there is huge requirement for skilled manpower. We'll also think about connecting with this. This is what I want to tell you. Two questions that has come forth, and I'll post it for you. Then I'll give the floor to the panel. You can comment on whatever I have mentioned. I would like to hear from Shalini ma'am and also the managing director of Fronium as to how we can go ahead. Now, the two questions are, one is regarding the return migrants, how Fronium and the Capital Goods Sector Skill Council can help ASAP in address targeting this community. Second is whether Fronium can establish a welding lab in Kundanthanam Community Skill Park under the CSR initiative. This is something which a participant has asked us. So thank you so much. Over to you, Shalini.
Okay,
Thank you so much for summarizing the entire session. Your question, point number one, in terms of how we can work together to help the return migrants in upskilling and reskilling. I think I've mentioned the point that, you know, we have our existing, we have been doing upskilling and reskilling with industry from the day one. And, you know, primarily the reason is that the need of the industry. So we were doing trainings for the existing workforce of the various industries. Now, similarly, when these migrants will come, we can definitely work together and build certain short courses for them, depending upon the skill gap that they have and the need of the industry. So, I mean, I think we can take this up and we can, because there's a lot of demands from different states also, where a lot of migrants have come back and now they're jobless and we really don't know what to do with them. So I think we can definitely work together. What we require from your side is that if you can give us what kind of a skill set you would, you know, the current migrant has and how we can convert it into upskilling and reskilling to them. So once we get some kind of, you know, arrangement, then we can, you know, work on those qualifications and build a shorter courses so that they are employable in different industries. This is my point.
Thank you, ma'am. So we'll definitely come back to you with that input as to once we get an idea as to what the skill gap is as far as the return migrants are concerned and the young graduates are concerned. We will think about such opportunities and about future skills. Again, we'll hold a separate section. So we'll combine both and we'll finalize a plan of action for the next, say, 6 months or 1 year.
Yeah, sure. I think we look forward to holding a, you know, focused session on Industry 4.0, yeah, where we'll be talking more about future skills that is required in manufacturing industry.
Kamal sir, would you like to add something?
Yes, thanks for this opportunity. I think last 1.5 hour or 1 hour 40 minutes went on very well. Coming back to, you talked about the migrant worker. So when it's very specific to Kerala, the migrant workers are basically from people who have come back from the other countries rather than other states of India. So, and mostly it is from GCC. And the GCC countries have definitely the technology what these workers are using are at least a few notches more than what we are using in India for fabrication. So to skill them again in India, yes, we can do it, provided you support us in getting the pool of the migrant workers. If they have, if you have that data bank, then we can have a webinar with those people and understand that what exactly they is the gap or the where we need to bridge the gap. And then in the course, because we are not able to travel now, at least for next 1 month or 1.5 month, we have two institutes in Kerala. One is at Cochin, that Little Flower Engineering Institute, and TSS in Trivandrum. I think we can connect these people to this institute and they can get upskilled or reskilled in this institute. So we can talk to the management of these two institutes and we can, as a Fronius, we can also support them. Second question is about CSR. Thanks for this question. We have been doing, Fronius India is doing this CSR. We are not 500 crores company in India as on now. So our CSR funds are basically in terms of knowledge transfer rather than the equipment transfer. Me and my team are totally dedicated to ensure that welding is gets its due importance. I'm sure you would have heard when Mr. Shashyanand talking that we want to call welders as not welders, we want to call them as a joining specialist. We are running a campaign in social media from last 1 week saying that give a missed call campaign. So anybody who is in the field of welding, they can give a missed call to a number which is displayed in our social media. And we are upgrading them to joining specialists by giving the technical tips. And we have many programs planned for them. So at this point of time, after COVID, when everybody is economically challenged, it's not possible, but we can definitely do a lot of knowledge transfer like what the sessions we are having and also connecting it to the right people and connecting the right thoughts. Madam Shalini Singh talked about Industry 4.0. We are absolutely Industry 4.0 is in action in India. in welding. We have few customers. In fact, when I'm talking to you, I can show you what's welding happening in my headquarters in Austria, and sitting at on your computer, you can also see what's welding happening in my lab in Pune. So it's already in action. Many customers are using our Industry 4.0 in action. We would be more than happy to join hands with Capital Good Skill Council in conducting Industry 4.0 in welding program for the interested participant. So that's all from my side, sir. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Thank you so much, sir. We are so excited to hear from you about the missed call campaign. I'm sure that there'll be many welders out there to hear all those things. So if you could please share with us the social media link, we will publicize it through our social media channels. And how long will this campaign be?
We are running this campaign till June 30th, sir. So the idea is to get the data bank of all the welders in India and then take them to the next level of joining specialist in terms of technical and skill upgradation. That's the plan. We will share. My colleague Shashyanand will send you the link, sir.
Okay, we'll follow it up. Right. And so we'll definitely think about connecting with your centers here as far as short term training upskilling programs are concerned, the Trivandrum and Cochin centers. So after today's meeting, our team will prepare a minutes of the meeting and action plan, and we will share it with the Capital Goods Sector Skill Council as well as Fronius. So that will be the starting point. So this is not an end, but this is a great beginning. So lots of things are going to happen in this sector from this discussion. We are so grateful to the Capital Goods Sector Skill Council, their entire top leadership. They are here devoting 2 hours for the additional skill acquisition program. Thank you so much, Shalini ma'am, Nirbhai Srivastava ji, and all those things, all those persons from the sector. And big thanks to the Fronius team. We're so happy that you came to us. A global presence, you are heavily present in Kerala, and it's just a matter of joining ends. So we'll do that. So this is a great beginning, and I would like to tell you that very soon we'll be starting with the further programs. Now, again, I would like to thank all the people who made this possible. The Rahul, especially the team, the sector team from Additional Skill Acquisition Program. I would like to also thank the ESAP management, Dr. Vinod, who was there giving the initial introduction. So Shalini ma'am, would you like to say something as a closing statement? Shalini ma'am, can you hear me? Would you like to say something as a closing statement? Okay, come on, sir. I think ma'am, can you hear me? Yeah, would you like to say something in the, as a closing statement? Ma'am, you are muted. Would you please unmute? Okay. So thank you so much, ma'am. There seems to be some audio issue. I'm not being able to hear you. I don't know whether others can hear you.
No.
Sir, from CGSC side, what we'll say, we'll get in touch with you for the details and how to work it out. And from our side, it will be 100% support to ASAP and with our all stakeholders who are there.
Yeah.
So, yeah. And we are looking forward to all kinds of courses from, say, short-term trainings to reskilling, upskilling, to apprenticeship, to industry interns and all those things. So we'll together work it out, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Capital Statistical Council and Fronius, the entire team. Kamal sir, Path sir, sir, Jinesh, everyone. Thank you, Shalini ma'am. Thank you, Nirbhai Shivastav ji. Thanks to the SAP team, Rahul, Vinod, and everyone. Ashish Shapting, I forgot to mention you, sir. Thank you. Thank you for your support. Thanks everyone. We'll close this session. It has been a wonderful session. We look forward to further engagement. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Kamal.
Yeah. Thank you, Shalini ma'am, for taking out time and spending almost 1.5 hours. We had a lot of preparation done in the past. Thanks everyone, and thanks Sasi, thanks Jinesh. For motivating the entire team in Malayalam. I could understand a few words, but that's fine. I will like to get it translated. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you everyone. Thank you. See you also. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Jai Hind. Thank you, Dr. Jacqueline. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.